milk thistle, sulforaphane, and blood donation for iron overload.
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode. Gary Krieger says, hi, Chris. In your last AMA, you mentioned using milk thistle or sulforaphane to move iron from serum to ferritin. Would this be considered a normal physiological option or more a backdoor approach to lower elevated transferrin saturation? I understand hypothyroidism and MTHFR single nucleotide polymorphisms can cause elevated transferrin saturation and low ferritin. How would you best address these conditions to lower transferrin saturation? Recent labs of mine have put transferrin saturation in the range of 39 to 46 and ferritin 60 to 70, TSH 2.85, reverse T3 18, free T3 mid-range. Thank you. If that was me, I would be giving blood. And the way that I look at this is, I think there's a lot of confusion that is driven by looking at ferritin as if it's a universal singular marker of iron status, which is completely not. And I think there's a lot of muddled thinking that comes around the diagnostic criteria used for hemochromatosis. And so what gets lost in the observation that people with diagnosable hemochromatosis have really high ferritin is that the mechanism that begins at decades before that's found is that the communication between elevated transferrin saturation and the hepcidin system that lowers iron absorption and increases ferritin is broken. So it should happen, if that situation is working correctly, is that as your transferrin saturation moves up between 30 and 40%, there's a cascade of physiological responses to that lower your iron absorption and that increase your ferritin. So if you were to find someone when that first happened, not after they had diagnosable hemochromatosis, if you were to find someone who it was in the initial stages of recognizing that pattern, what you would find is that their transferrin saturation would be quite high and their ferritin would be much lower than you would expect it to be. Because the thing that's broken is the ferritin doesn't respond to the transferrin saturation. So the default for me is to read a transferrin saturation that's consistently above 40%. And now, granted, 39 to 46 is only a little bit above 40%, right? So I am homozygous for H63D. When I first discovered that I had iron overload issues, my transferrin saturation was at 55%, and I was in my early 20s. So 39 to 46 is like barely out of the range. And I guess it's not as if giving blood once is dangerous for, you know, most cases. So I don't see that as a problem. Although, you know, maybe if you're worried about COVID or you hate needles or you're not, you know, whatever, you might want to wait it out and see where that goes. But if that's an increasing trend, I personally am going to, if that were me, I'd be interpreting that as early iron overload. And yeah, the ferritin is 60 to 70 and it'll go down with iron overload, but with blood donation. But personally, when I'm concerned about iron overload, I'm okay letting ferritin go down to 20 to 40. Whereas if I'm concerned about anemia, iron deficiency anemia, I'm not. I'm going to want to make sure ferritin stays above 60. Now the question arises, why does someone, if in hemochromatosis, the communication between high transferrin saturation and ferritin is broken, why does ferritin go up so high? The answer is that oxidative stress results from high free iron, which correlates with high transferrin saturation. And it's the oxidative stress that drives the ferritin so high. And the logic in the last AMA of talking about milk thistle and sulforaphane was to help get the hormesis, or the perception of oxidative stress from those supplements, to jack up the oxidative stress response to get a higher ferritin reaction. But, you know, if your ferritin is 60, 70 and you're giving blood, then you probably want to do what the blood donation people will already do for you, which is make sure you don't run iron deficient. But, you know, you could enhance that a little bit by making sure also sure that your hemoglobin, hematocrit, red blood cells and whatnot don't go low. Now, the last thing is, if your transferrin saturation is a little bit high, you really should make sure that your albumin doesn't run a little bit low. Because if your albumin runs a little bit low, it's going to make your transferrin saturation look a little bit high and it's going to be false. And that's, transferrin saturation is sort of like calculated LDL. It's not the thing you want, but most of the time it's good enough. And so with borderline high transferrin saturation, where you're not convinced of iron overload, you really should look at actual transferrin saturation. And there's a formula in testing nutritional status, the ultimate cheat sheet, to calculate that. But the measurements required would be, at the same time you get the iron panel, get the serum transferrin. And I personally would say, you could do it just serum iron and serum transferrin, but my preference would be get serum ferritin and get serum transferrin and get the iron panel. That way you can correlate them. So, you know, you can say, when my iron saturation is 40%, what does my transferrin saturation calculate to? And is iron saturation actually a good proxy or is it not? And that would require like three measurements where you take them together to look at their correlation. So I guess number one would be, see if it's a fake correlation by looking at actual transferrin saturation. Number two would be, make sure it's an uptrend and it's not a fluke. Like if it was 39 and it was 46, and next time it's 37, it's probably a fluke. But if it's an uptrend, you probably want to do something about it. And yes, you could try someone in that situation could try the NRF2 stimulators like milk thistle and sulforaphane. But if it is a genuine uptrend in early stage iron overload, you know, that might be a situation that giving blood once a year would be the best solution. All right. Thank you, Gary, for your question.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. As a bonus, you also get to participate in monthly private Zoom Q&As with me. You can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled out as Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for a 10% lifetime discount.
From now through February or March, whatever it takes to get it done, I will be working full-time on finishing my Vitamins and Minerals 101 book while reserving a portion of my time for my consulting clients. You can pre-order my book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book.
In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. I will try to respond to comments here when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.